a lot to the organizers for invitation. So what I would like to do in these lectures is to give you an overview of a number of classical results in holomorphic dynamics, in a number of classical results in one-dimensional holomorphic dynamics, and try to understand what they become in higher dimensions. Okay, so I think it's one of the ideas of this conference of how to go from one dimensions to higher dimension for groups. And I will try to keep this idea in mind of stating classical things in one dimension and see how they evolved in higher dimension. So the one-dimensional part will be very classical, so perhaps many of you have already heard about this in great detail, so I apologize for that. I will give a number of proofs, at least for the one-dimensional case. So the overall plan would be something like that. So in the first lecture, so if everything is fine, in the first lecture, I want to talk about the Fatou-Julia dichotomy of dynamical space. So again, in one and several dimensions. In lecture two, I want to talk about equidistribution aspects. So I want to talk about equidistribution. So there will be a little bit of ergodic theory. And lecture three should be about parameter spaces and bifurcations. So hopefully I'll be able to maintain the schedule, but it's not clear whether this will not contaminate the whole three lectures. We'll see. Okay, so again, I will try to give you some proofs in one dimension and some statements in higher dimension. Okay, so let's start with lecture one. So lecture one has part R and part A and part B, and part A is dimension one. Okay, so I want to iterate an algebraic map of a one-dimensional algebraic variety. So I take a certain f from x to x, where everything is algebraic, and x is one-dimensional. So, and what I want to do with f is iterate it. Iterate, so consider forward iterates of this. So I view this as a dynamical system. I want to predict the future of points. Okay, I have a point. I would like to know what it will become in the future. So the first thing is that if you want to iterate an algebraic map on an algebraic Riemann surface, you don't have many, many choices. So first case, so let's start with the easiest case. First case that x, so if you have, when you have an algebraic Riemann surface, you can always compactify it by adding a few points, okay? So you can always assume that x is compact. You can always assume that it's a compact Riemann surface, okay? And F will extend holomorphically to the compactification. This will be different in higher dimension. So first case is when the genus of X is larger than 2. And in that case, just by looking at the Euler characteristic, you see that F must be an automorphism. And in that case, the automorphism group is finite. So in that case, F must be an automorphism, and this is a finite group. So in that case, of course, for dynamical systems, it's not very interesting. We throw that away. Second case, genus one, when X is an elliptic curve. In that case, your map must descend from an affine map on C. Then F descends from an affine map. In that case, the dynamics can be complicated, but still it's completely explicit. You can compute the iterates. So you consider that it's not interesting from the dynamical point of view. So it's, let's say it's easy. Even if, again, the dynamics can be chaotic. And the last case, which will be the one that we are interested in, is the case of rational mappings on the Riemann sphere. So that's the genus zero case. So genus zero. Okay, so in that case, X is the Riemann sphere, or equivalently, the one-dimensional complex projective space. So I will switch between these two ideas of a sphere versus projective space. I mean, I think most people here know about the relationship. And F is a rational map. So the degree of F is the maximum of the degree of the components. Again, the situation is not very interesting when the degree is 1. So I always assume that this is larger than 1. Okay? So this is my dynamical setting. I want to iterate a rational map on the Riemann sphere. So that's the setting for all this one-dimensional part of the lecture. Okay, so that was section 1, setting. So section 2, number of basic concepts. So one important basic concept here is that of a normal family. So a normal family of holomorphic mappings from a certain domain. So omega is a domain in the Riemann, an open set in the Riemann sphere to the Riemann sphere, is just a relatively compact family of holomorphic mappings. So now this normal stuff is just old terminology. It just means that it is relatively compact in the space of holomorphic mapping. Okay, and it's also very classical. That's, it's the same as being equicontinuous. Equicontinuous for the spherical metric. Okay? So there is one important and classical theorem here, which is Montel theorem. So that's one basic tool. Montel's theorem. Any family of holomorphic mappings avoiding 3 points is normal. So any holomorphic family. No, let me state like that. The family of holomorphic mapping from some set omega to the sphere minus 3 points is normal. Okay, so of course this must be a distinct point, right? And the proof in 2 lines. The proof is that the universal cover of this is the unit disk. So the proof is that the universal cover. So consider the universal cover. So this is covered by the unit disk. And if you take any holomorphic map, if you take any holomorphic map from omega to C minus 3 points, C hat minus 3 points, you can lift it to the universal cover. And now a bounded family of holomorphic mapping is, okay, so perhaps you should assume that omega here is not the, is contained in C, right? It's a proper domain, so if it's proper, it avoids 1 point. And if it avoids 1 point, you can always assume that this point is infinity. Okay, so now it's a family of holomorphic mappings in the classical sense from omega to the unit disk, and then it's just, it's equicontinuous, and if you take the holomorphic mapping from omega to the unit disk, it is equicontinuous, Equicontinuous, I mean on compact subsets, okay? So it's a locally equicontinuous, just because of the Cauchy estimates. Okay, and that's the proof. So that's one basic tool. The other important tool in one dimension is the Poincaré metric. I think it has been seen a number of times in this conference, so I don't want to say too much about it. So what do we want to say? So a Riemann surface is hyperbolic if its universal cover is the disk. And essentially, all Riemann surfaces are hyperbolic, except so X Riemann surface is hyperbolic unless it belongs to a small number of examples. It is, so there's the sphere, the plane, puncture plane, C mod Z, and C mod lattice. Okay, so it's the, if X is not one of these examples, then it's a hyperbolic Riemann surface. Okay? And then you get a Poincaré metric. You get a Poincaré metric on X just by pushing the metric from the Poincaré metric from the universal cover. And the important property here is the Schwarz lemma. The Schwarz lemma says that a holomorphic mapping between a hyperbolic Riemann surface is always weakly contracting. So let F be a holomorphic mapping between hyperbolic Riemann surfaces, between hyperbolic Riemann surfaces, then the distance, it is a weak contraction. So this, the distance with respect to the matrix of X prime between images is less than the distance at the source. And also, you know, even more than that, you know the equality case. And actually, it is a strict contraction. So it is a strict contraction unless F is a cover. So, of course, you imagine that in dynamical situations, it's very useful information to have contractions. Okay, so now let's start to do dynamics. So, what's the Fatou-Julia dichotomy? I think everybody in this room knows what it is. Okay, so let's define the Fatou set. So again, I take F, a rational mapping of degree at least 2 from the sphere to itself, and I define the Fatou set. So the Fatou set is the local equicontinuity set, F. It is the set of points Z in the sphere such that there exists a neighborhood of Z such that the family of iterates restricted to this neighborhood is a normal family. So you see that by definition, it's an open set, and it is invariant under F, and also invariant under F inverse. So it is open and totally invariant, meaning that F of the Fatou set is also F inverse of the Fatou set, is the Fatou set. And the Julia set, it's just a complement of the Fatou set. So it is a set of points where the family is not locally equicontinuous. Now I realize that I should have prepared a number of pictures, but I didn't. So you just have to imagine pictures of Julia set. I think there may be some in the back of the room, no? In every mathematical room, there should be a picture of a Julius head, but for some reason here, there's no. Okay, so let me give you a few examples. No, let me not give you a few examples. So you know that you get these fractal pictures, and the most famous fractal is the circle, corresponding to f being z to the power d. So example, f of z is z squared. So what happens to points under iteration of z squared? Well, if the modulus is smaller than 1, you go to 0. So it's equicontinuous. If your modulus is bigger than 1, you go to infinity, which is also equicontinuous for the spherical metric. And if the modulus is equal to 1, you don't know where you want to go. You are separate, well, you are in between the two. So certainly in the neighborhood, the family cannot be normal, right? So the Julia set is the unit circle. Okay? And that will be our only example of Julia set. Okay. This morning we heard the name quasi-circle. Okay? So if you perturb a little bit this, and actually epsilon can be as large as 1/4, then the Julia set is homeomorphic to a circle. Is homeomorphic to a circle. So you see a deformation homeomorphic to the circle. So not only it's homeomorphic, but it deforms continuously. So you start with a circle. You start with a circle, and when you start to move epsilon, so I should have used this one anyway, you see this circle moving to a picture which is not smooth, which is a quasi-circle. So this could be a quasi. So a quasi-circle has no inward pointing cusps. So when you draw one, you should make cusps point on the outside. Anyway, so when you deform, when you take small epsilon, you see a picture like that. Okay, and when you go, when epsilon is larger than one, real and larger than 1/4, you have a Cantor set, and you get plenty of pictures. Let's proceed without the pictures. And so the Julia set is closed, and also it is totally invariant. So the first thing I will do is to characterize, well, to talk about these closed totally invariant sets. So let's say that E is an exceptional set, is exceptional if it is finite. So it is a subset of the sphere, if it is finite and totally invariant. And there's a proposition here, easy proposition. There is a maximal exceptional set. Let's call it E naught. And the cardinality of this set is at most 2. So what it says that you can have, let's say also that a point is exceptional. The point Z in the sphere is exceptional if it belongs to an exceptional set. It means that, equivalently, it has finitely many preimages. You take all possible preimages and you just get a finite set. And what the proposition says is that there are at most 2 exceptional points. Okay? That's the worst you can do. And the proof is...
So, an exceptional set is also invariant.
Yes. Okay, I don't want... but you don't need to assume that. I mean, it's just a... Yes. Yes, perhaps you need to add it in the definition. I don't think so. Well, the important, perhaps I should have just talked about exceptional point. An exceptional point is a point which has finitely many preimages. That's the important concept. Okay? And the proposition is that there are almost 2 exceptional points. Okay? Okay, the proof is easy. The proof is just the Riemann-Ritz formula. So if you have an exceptional set, you get a mapping from C, from the Riemann sphere minus the exceptional set from itself to itself. So F induces a mapping like that. You apply the Riemann-Ritz formula. So the Euler characteristic of sphere minus E, D times is equal to D times itself minus a certain ramification term which is non-negative, right? So this cannot be a negative number. Otherwise, it would grow, it would go to infinity. So it means that this number has to be non-negative. It has to be non-negative. But this number is just 2 minus the cardinality of E. Just 2 minus cardinality of E. Okay, so you get the result. So this has consequences. Which consequence? So another proposition. So let me just, okay, just a classification, perhaps a small classification of the possibilities here. It happens in generic cases, the exceptional set is empty. Okay, you have no exceptional point. Now, if the exceptional set is just one point, you can always declare that this point is infinity. And what is a rational map with infinity total invariant? It's a rational map with no pole, so it's a polynomial. So E, one exceptional point corresponds to polynomials, and two exceptional points, you only have the examples of Z to the D and Z to the minus D, up to conjugacy, okay? So generic case, no exceptional point, one exceptional point means polynomial, and there's one last case. Okay, proposition. If Z is any point which is not exceptional, then if you take the union of prime edges of Z and take the closure, then it must contain the Juvia set. And the proof is just Montel theorems. The proof is that if I take Z naught P in the Juvia set and a neighborhood of P, then the union of forward images of this neighborhood, it's a certain open subset which misses at most two points, and it is invariant. So it is open, it is forward invariant, and it misses at most two points. So it means that its complement must be an exceptional set. So the complement of this is exceptional. So Z is not here. So it means that you take prime edges of Z, you must enter N. So when you take prime edges of Z, you must get close to P. Okay? So that's the end of the proof. And a corollary of that is that if now, so you know, a remark, I should have made a remark that the Juvia set is never empty. It's just because the degree is at least 2, so you know that some complexity should arise under iteration. So the Juvia set is not empty, and the corollary of that is that the Juvia set is actually infinite and also perfect. And the reason is that if, the proof of that is that if Z is a point in the Juvia set, and we know that it's not empty, then the Juvia set is just the union, the closure of union of prime edges of Z. And it's, an exceptional point is always in the Fatou set. As I said, one possibility is infinity for a polynomial, and the other possibility is zero and infinity for ZD. So you are in the Fatou set. So if you start with a point in the Juvia set, you know that it's not exceptional. So when you take prime edges, you have this property, And then you get equality here. So it says that the Julia set is perfect and infinite, right? So we get one first property of the Julia set. So there are plenty of other. So we saw this property for limit sets this morning, right? Another property, which I won't prove, it's a theorem by Fatou. And Julia, I would say Fatou and Julia. No, excuse me, I will say it later. Sorry. First, I want to talk about periodic points. So that's section 3, 4, periodic points. So finding a periodic point of period n for f is just solving an equation of degree d to the n, right? So you know that f has d to the n plus 1 periodic points of period n, counting multiplicities of period n, of period dividing n. This is just because you solve the equation fn of z equals z. That's just an algebraic equation. So you know that you have plenty of periodic points, right? So now if z naught is periodic, if z naught is periodic of exact period. So now when your point is periodic of period n, it's also periodic of period 2n, 4n, and so on. Okay, so it has a minimal one, and I will say that it's the exact period. So if z naught is periodic of exact period n, then you define, you can look at the derivative of fn at this point. This is a number. So you have to consider the spherical metric here, but since you consider it at the beginning and at the end, you just can consider it's a derivative, right? So this number is called the multiplier of z naught. Okay, and just by applying the Taylor formula, you know that the multiplier determines the action of f in the small neighborhood, fn in the small neighborhood of z naught. So it determines the, at the first order, it's the main, excuse me, I missed the word. It's the main character for the local dynamics of fn at this point. So there are a few cases. So let's assume, so you can always assume that n equals 1 just by replacing f by fn. So first case, the multiplier is less than 1 in modulus, then the point is attracting. It attracts a neighborhood. Z naught is, let me keep the n. Z naught is attracting. So there is not much to say. You have a point z naught here. It has a certain basin of attraction, and all points nearby go to this one. And then it belongs to the Fatou set. Then if the multiplier is bigger than 1, and the point is repelling, so in that case, you cannot describe the whole dynamics of a point in the neighborhood because it will go far away, and then it does something. But in any case, you know that the sequence of derivatives at z naught goes to infinity, so you must be in the Julia set. And you cannot say much more than that. Third case, more interesting one, multiplier is 1. Then you say it's neutral. Then you can have several subcases. So let me describe a few of them. First, there's a lemma. So I would like to know whether a neutral point belongs to the Julia set or to the Fatou set. Okay, so there's a lemma here. So a neutral fixed point, neutral periodic point, fixed point. So again, you can always assume it's fixed just by replacing f by fn, belongs to the Fatou set. If and only if it is linearizable. So linearizable means that you have z naught here, which is an f, excuse me, and you want to know if it is conjugate to the action of the linear part in the neighborhood of the origin, where lambda is just the multiplier of. So, I'm going too fast here. You know that the multiplier determines the local dynamics of at z naught. So you can always imagine that z naught is zero, of course. Okay? And you want to know if it is conjugate or not to the multiplication by lambda. And what I say is that this is true if and only if the periodic point is in the Fatou set. So one implication is clear. So the linearizable implies Fatou is clear, because if the map is conjugate to a multiplication by a complex number of modulus 1, you have a quick continuity. For the forward implication, there's a little trick. And the trick is this one. You consider Hn. It's a sequence of mappings. And this is this one, 1 over n, sum of lambda. So I assume that z naught is equal to 0. So that's a local statement. It has nothing to do with rational mappings. It's a statement for local mappings defined in the neighborhood of the origin. So I assume that z naught is 0. And f is just a germ from C0 to itself with a multiplier lambda. And I will consider this sequence of mappings. N is not good here. So we'll define a sequence of holomorphic functions like that. So it's a Cesaro sum of this sequence. So if I name this GK, you remark that GK plus 1 is just lambda GK plus 1 is just GK composed with F. Okay? And also you can remark that all these mappings have derivative 1 at the origin. Okay? So H n prime at the origin is 1. Okay, now if z naught belongs to the Fatou set, it means that Fn is equicontinuous, so it has bounded derivative in the neighborhood. So lambda to the minus k, lambda is as modulus 1, right? So this is GK is equicontinuous, so Hn is also a normal family. So you can extract Hn is a normal sequence. Is a normal sequence. And now by construction, Hn plus 1, what is the composed with F minus lambda Hn goes to 0 by construction. Okay, this is just because when you compose with F, it just corresponds to a shift in this sum, and you have this 1 over n. It's the same trick as, constructing periodic a fixed point by taking a Cesaro mean. Okay? When you have this, when you want to prove this Markov-Kakutani theorem that when you have an affine map of a compact convex set, it has a fixed point, you just take a Cesaro mean, and if you take any cluster value of the Cesaro mean, it must be a fixed point because terms just cancel. And here it's exactly the same. Okay, when you compute this, you get that this is going to 0. So if you take any cluster value, H of this sequence satisfies H composed with F is lambda H. And also it has the derivative 1 at the origin. Okay, so it is a linearizing map. It is it's a local diffeomorphism which conjugates F to its derivative, right? So that's the proof of my lemma. So proving that a neutral point belongs to the Julia set is exactly the same as proving that it's linearizable. So a corollary of that is that, so in the neutral case, you have two, if you have a neutral point, you have two cases. So you write the multiplier as the exponential of 2 pi theta. So either theta is rational or it's irrational. So if theta is rational, you see that it's a parabolic point. And if it's not, I don't know. You say that it's just an irrational neutral point. In that case, you see that the linear map has finite order. So it cannot happen for F, because for my rational mapping, has degree bigger than 1. So it's certainly not of finite order. So a corollary of that is that a parabolic point, it is not, it cannot be linearizable in my case. And actually, it belongs to the Julia set. Okay, actually, you can say a little bit more about the dynamics near parabolic points. So the typical example is like that. So a typical example is f of z is z plus z squared. So the derivative at the origin is 1. Okay, and you just have one perturbative term. And the dynamics near the origin, so on the real axis, you know the dynamics on the real axis. It is, so z plus z squared, something like that. Okay, it is attracting on one side and repelling on the other side. Okay, if you start with a point here, you do something like that. You will go to the origin, and on the other side, you go to infinity. Right? In the complex number, it's the same. So when you have this, so that's 0. 0 is attracting on a certain cone on the left-hand side. So you have an attracting basin here, and you have a repelling basin here. And actually, you can even say a little bit more. Excuse me, the picture is like that. You have a certain cardioid-shaped picture where the dynamics is attracting like that, and it is repelling on the other side. Okay, so that's the tip. So my arrow here is going to the fixed point. So you have a certain basin of attraction, and 0 is on the boundary of the basin. Okay, and it's repelling on the other side. So certainly, this is a point in the Julia set, right? Because you have no neighborhood where the dynamics is staying. In the irrational case, the situation is more complicated. So you certainly know that the problem of linearizing holomorphic diffeomorphism is very complicated. So let me just say a few names here. So Zigo, so in the 40s, proved that for certain values of theta, I don't want to be too precise here, certain values of theta, every holomorphic mapping with multiplier like that is linearizable. F is linearizable. And Kremer, again in the 40s, I think, prove that for certain value of theta, F is not linearizable. Okay, so there are certain values of theta which ensure that F is never linearizable unless it is already linear, right? Yeah, of course, you can start with a linear map. So actually, excuse me, so what Kremer proved is that for certain values of theta, this mapping is not linearizable. Okay? And actually, for quadratic polynomials, so we know exactly that that's a theorem of Yoko's, famous theorem of Yoko's, that we know exactly the set of parameters theta such that the mapping is linearizable. There's an open question. So for your cause, give a complete answer to this problem. For quadratic polynomials. Okay, and also, and this is based on the work of Bruno. And so there's a sufficient, so the situation right now is that there's a certain sufficient condition for linearizability, which is called the Bruno condition. It is known that the Bruno condition is optimal for quadratic polynomials, but it is not known for in any other setting. Okay? So that's an open question, an interesting open question, whether for rational mapping on P1, the question of linearizability depends only on the angle. Okay? So it's not known if this property of being linearizable or not depends only on theta. It is known for quadratic polynomials, but not for general rational mapping. So that's an important open question in the field. Okay, I'm going too slow here. One theorem by Fatou and Julia, which was proved in simultaneously, basically. The Julia set is the closure of the set of periodic points, of repelling points. So you look at the set of repelling periodic points and take the closure, you get the Julia set. Okay, so again, this is a property which looks like the corresponding one for Kleinian groups in one dimension. Another theorem, due to perhaps a, I don't know if it's a theorem of a lemma or whatever, is that every attracting point attracts a critical point. And the proof is two lines. Proof. Look at the basin. So look at the basin, the immediate basin of A. So you have an attracting point A. It has a certain basin. So the basin has many components, but you look at the component containing A, which is called the immediate basin. And now F. So the proof. Excuse me. Okay, yes. I'm just... F is a self-map from the immediate basin to itself, right? And assume that F is a covering. So assume that there's no... So here there's an implication I'm not completely sure of, but okay. Assume there's no critical point, then F is a covering. So it's true, but it requires a few lines of justification. So if it's a covering, it's an isometry for the Poincaré metric. And then you contradict the fact that A is attracting. Okay, so it's not a covering, so it must have a critical point. Okay, so it is not a covering. So you just conclude by the Schwarz lemma. So a corollary of that is that the number of attracting points is finite. So a corollary of that, the number of attracting points, periodic points, is finite. Just because there's a finite number of critical points. Okay, there's a slightly more complicated theorem that the number of non-repelling points is also finite. So actually, when you look at periodic points for rational mappings, almost all of them are repelling, except a few of them, and actually the bound is 2d minus 2. So this bound is due to Shishikoha, so it's optimal. And there's a list of previous bounds, and I think the first one was due to Fatou. It was 6d minus 6. And a proof looks like that. One proof looks like that. You take your rational mapping for proof. That's not. I think you can make it work. I'm not sure. Take F, a rational map, Okay, so you know that it has finitely many attracting cycles. Perhaps it has a certain number of neutral ones. Now, if you perturb F in the space of rational map, what you expect is that half of the neutral points will go inside the unit circle, and half of them will go outside the unit circle. So you know that the number of attracting points of F is less than 2d minus 2, number of critical points. And the number by perturbation, so for nearby F, you get that the number of attracting points of F plus half of the neutral points is less than 2d minus 2. Okay? So again, if you perturb, for generic perturbation, what you should expect, and this is true after some work, that half of the neutral point becomes repelling and half of them become attracting. This is a matter of saying that there are enough parameters in the enough parameters, and also that the multiplier map. So if you want to prove something like that, you need to show that the multiplier map is because the space of rational map is big. It's 2D minus 2. So you have to prove that it's a submersion to C. And also, okay, if you look at the space, okay, you're right that you need some work. At least that's an idea of proof. I don't remember if you can make this work or not. I don't remember. Okay? But in any case, the idea is that half of them will become neutral, half of them will become repelling. I totally agree that you can imagine that some bad situation happened. Okay? At least from this idea, if you do some graphical analysis from this, you get that the number of attracting plus neutral point is less than 4d minus 4. So you still need more work to get this. Okay? 2d minus 2 is optimal, yes. Yes. And it's done by quasi-conformal techniques. Okay. Okay, that's it for periodic points. So I want to talk about the FATU set now. Okay, so next item, FATU components. So I should have made a remark. In my properties, I forgot one property of the Julia set. So let me add it somewhere. So one property of the Julia set is that the interior of the Julia set is empty, unless it's the whole sphere. Okay, again, this is just Montel theorem. If not, if you take a component of the interior of the Julia set, it must have the iterates must be contained in the interior of the Julia set and must avoid at most two points. Okay, so it must be written. So it's just a Montel theorem. So now remember the basic problem of dynamical systems is describe the behavior of orbits, or at least describe the behavior of most orbits. So since the Julia set has empty interior, in first approximation, you can try to describe the orbits in the FATU set. If you're able to describe the orbits in the FATU set, you've done almost all points in a topological sense. Okay? So a remark here. So there's the theorem by Buff and Sherita. That's not a theorem. Huh? Buff and Sherita. It can happen that the Lebesgue measure is positive. Actually, in the... Yes. It may happen. That the measure of the Julia set is positive, but J is not the whole sphere. Okay? So it means that if you want to describe the behavior of almost all points in the Lebesgue sense, you need a little bit more. But at least in a topological sense, you can restrict to FATU components. And the good news is that you can describe everything. Okay? So what are the So if you want to study dynamics in the FATU set, so the dynamics is locally, it's a normal family. So in a sense, the dynamics is locally constant in FATU components. So it's enough to describe dynamics in the whole FATU components. So a FATU component, it can be periodic. So you have a certain iterate which maps the component to itself. Let me remove this center here. It can be a pre-periodic. So the picture is you have your component, which is mapped after a few iterates to something which becomes periodic. And the last possibility is that it is wandering. Okay, look. So these are the three possible cases. So in a few minutes, I will say that wandering components do not exist for rational mappings, but it is easy to cook up examples of transcendental mappings with wandering FATU components. So example is something like that. If you look at this mapping, f of z is z minus the sine of z plus 2 pi. So that's an entire mapping from C to C, and which satisfies f of z plus 2 pi is equal to f of z plus 2 pi. Okay, so it induces a mapping from C mod 2 pi z to itself. So now, if you look at 0, so 0 is mapped to 2 pi, so on C mod 2 pi z, 0 is a fixed point. And if you look at the multiplier, z minus sine z, it's a super attracting fixed point. So in the quotient, so the quotient is just a cylinder, right? That's c mod 2 pi z. You have 0 here, and it has a certain attracting basin. Now if you look in C, what happens? So you have this attracting basin which comes from the from the cylinder, and you have the same around every multiple of 2 pi. But now, since I added 2 pi in the formula, if you start with a point here, it will be mapped to the next copy of the basin, okay, and so on.
So
good question. Good question. I guess this is because you can have only one attracting point in because this point is fixed. No, because this point is mapped to the next one, and what? And what?
Yeah. I mean, if you
yes, I agree with that, but it's not possible because what? No, because the image of 0 is 2 pi. So no, the argument is not this one.
No, but it's for the original that c minus sine z.
Yes.
If you don't add 2 pi, then each point is
fixed. Yes, and it's the same basin.
But they are not the same basin.
Okay. Thanks for the argument. I forgot this one. Okay. So the argument is that the picture must be like that, because if you look at this mapping, you get the same picture in the quotient, okay? So, and in that case, each of these points is a fixed point. So they must correspond to distinct basins, okay? And now if you add the 2 pi, you see the same picture, but now you have this point mapped to the next one. Okay, thanks for the argument. Okay. So in that case, you get a wandering FATU component, okay? And associated to a transcendental map. And the theorem is that you can completely describe all possible types of FATU components. So theorem is like that. So it's due to a number of people, but the last step and most important one is Sullivan in something like 95 or 94, 85 or 84 something. So there are no wandering FATU components, so let F be rational. So the first thing is that there are no wandering FATU components. So every component is pre-periodic. So if you want to describe all of them, it is enough to describe the periodic ones. And every periodic component belongs to a fixed list of types. Periodic FATU component is of the following form. So as we, usually it's written as a five item theorem. So item 1 and 2 are basically the same. That's a super attracting or an attracting basin. So it means that it's the basin of attraction of some attracting point. So we have type 3, which is, there exists a certain, so let omega be a fixed FATU component. Okay, so another possibility is that there exists a certain point Z naught at the boundary of omega, whose multiplier is 1, so, which is fixed with multiplier 1, and omega is the basin of attraction of this parabolic point. And omega, and for every Z in omega, the iterator of Z converges to Z naught. So we have a parabolic point, and omega is just the attracting basin of this parabolic point. And the multiplier must be equal to 1 if the component is fixed. Fourth type, so that's the parabolic case, and then you have two more types which are called rotation domains. So omega is biholomorphic to a disk. So omega associated to its dynamics is biholomorphic to a disk with irrational rotation on it. Okay, so that's called a Ziegle disk. So the picture is like that. You have a certain disk with fractal boundary. Inside, you have a linearizable fixed point, and the dynamics around is that of a rotation. And type 5, omega f is biholomorphic to an annulus with an irrational rotation. So same picture. So these are called rotation domains. Okay, so this annulus cannot be a puncture disk. Otherwise, you would get an isolated point in the Julia set. So it must be an actual annulus. So we have an annulus like that. And it is foliated by smooth circles, and dynamics is a rotation on them. Okay, so let me try to prove the theorem. Okay, we'll not finish today, but let me prove it. Let me at least give ideas of proof. So proof, well, so I will not give, I will not explain the proof of the non-wandering FATU components. So the proof of, at least the idea of the proof of this non-wandering theorem is something like that. The argument, Sullivan's argument is saying something like, if you had a wandering FATU components, then you would be able to construct by quasi-conformal deformation an arbitrary large space of deformations of your rational map. Okay, but now the space of rational maps of degree D is finite dimensional, and then you get a contradiction. Okay, perhaps I should add a complement here. I should have a complement to this theorem, which is not trivial, and complement. there are only finitely many cycles of periodic components. Okay, so we already know that there are only finitely many non-repelling points. So it says that you have finitely many attracting basins, parabolic basins, and also Ziegler disks. But if you want finiteness for the number of Hermann, so this is called a Hermann ring. So the finiteness of the number of Hermann rings is more subtle, and you need again some quasi-conformal ideas to prove it. And so you see that this component, so this morning we heard about the Alfvers finiteness theorem. Okay, so it's the exact analog of the Alfvers finiteness theorem. And actually, it's the clue to the proof. So Sullivan saw this as the analog of the Alfvers finiteness theorem and used the tools to get the theorem here. Okay, the same, basically the same ideas. Okay, so I don't want to say more about that. Now, let me take, so let omega be a fixed Fatou component. Fixed Fatou component. So there are two cases. There are two cases. The recurrent case and the transient case. So transient means that for every z in omega, the iterates of z go to the boundary. Okay, points escape to infinity in omega. And the recurrent case is just the contraposite. There exists some z in omega such that z has infinitely many iterates in a compact set. So you see that in the transient case, all these cases are recurrent except the parabolic one. So something that we have to prove is that every transient Fatou component is a parabolic basin. So let's prove that. So there's one statement. So there's a fact, statement. One. A transient Fatou component. Invariant Fatou component. Fatou component. Is a parabolic basin. So, first argument in the proof, so you know that for every z in omega, the iterates go to the boundary. Now, remember that the f is weakly contracting for the Poincaré metric in omega. Okay, so now f, so of course omega is hyperbolic because it avoids at least two points, is weakly contracting for the Poincaré metric. Okay, so it means that, let me call it Zn. Zn is the nth iterator of Z. So the distance between Zn plus 1 and Zn for the Poincaré metric in omega is less than or equal to the distance from Z0 to Z1. So it's bounded. But now we know these points go to infinity in omega. So it is well known that the Poincaré metric at the boundary of the Poincaré metric is proper. Okay, so when you go to the boundary of a domain, the Poincaré metric diverges with respect to the spherical metric. So this implies, so this plus Zn goes to the boundary, implies that the spherical distance between Zn plus 1 and Zn must go to 0. Now if you look at the cluster values of this sequence, so every cluster value, so the set of cluster value of this sequence, set of cluster values is a connected set. So that's a classical lemma. When you have a sequence which satisfies this, the set of cluster values is connected. And it's a connected set of fixed points. Okay, but you have finitely many fixed points for your holomorphic map. So it is one fixed point. So Zn converges to some fixed point P in the boundary. You know that there must be a fixed point at the boundary and the n converges to it. And now, why the multiplier is equal to 1? So that's something called the Snell lemma. Which is due to Fatou, and which does exactly that. So it's a local statement. So let F be a germ of holomorphic map at the origin, fixing 0. Assume that there exists a certain open set such that F of U is contained in U. And for every z in U, fn of z converges to 0. And the conclusion is that the derivative is 1. And the proof goes like that. So you have your, so the set U, you must imagine, perhaps it's not a neighborhood of the origin, right? Just an open set which is mapped into itself. So U is something like that, and F of U perhaps is something like that. Anyway, it's a domain. It's a domain, it's a connected set. It's an open connected set. So you can, so that's my U. So Z0 is here, Z1 is here. I will consider a certain path joining Z0 to Z1, and I just take the iterates of this path. So let gamma0 be a path joining Z0 to Z1 in U, okay? And let gamma be the union of iterates of this gamma0. Okay, so this is a path going to the origin, because so 0 is somewhere on the boundary, perhaps. So you know that all these points here must converge to 0 under iteration. Okay, so this is a path converging to the origin under iteration, and which is invariant under f. Now, excuse me, I missed something here. The derivative at the origin must be of modulus 1. Okay? Otherwise, of course, it can be attracting. And it's exactly the case here, because my fixed point at the boundary cannot be an attracting point and cannot be a repelling point either. So it's exactly the situation which I have in my classification theorem. Okay, so what does this path look like? Actually, this path must look like a snail, because the dominant effect of F, so assume, so it's approved by contradiction. Assume that the derivative at 0 is different from 1. So it's a certain rotating complex number. So the dominating effect is the rotation. So if you look at this path gamma, it must converge to the origin like a snail, right? So gamma must look like that. Then the picture is that gamma is a certain path going slowly to the origin. Now, you take this snail here, so that's the origin. Take this snail and you cut a piece, you close it. Then you get a certain domain, so do you see it? The domain is here. So I make a little slit here to cut my snail to get a domain. And this domain is mapped into itself by the dynamics. Okay? Now, so it should be a contraction for the Poincaré metric. Okay, and again, you contradict the assumption on the multiplier. Okay, so I don't write the details here, but you make a certain slit to close the snail. Okay, and it's mapped into itself. So that's the proof of the snail lemma. Okay, so what we have done here is prove that any transient component must be the Bayesian of attraction of a certain parabolic point with multiplier 1. Now you have the recurrent case.
Because it's a normal family.
The distance, okay, Poincaré distance is constant. Well, it is decreased under iteration. Okay? And other argument is just normal families. Okay? You know that the limit, there's a certain limiting mapping, and this limit mapping is constant because it values in the boundary. Okay, so second case is the recurrent case. So there exists a certain z in omega such that fn of z accumulates a certain compact set. Okay, again, there are a number of subcases. So subcase one, F is not a covering. Okay? So in that case, if you work a little bit using the contraction of the Poincaré metric, the fact that the Poincaré metric must be a strict contraction, then you get, so there's a little bit of work here, okay, but it's not very difficult. Then you get that necessarily everybody must converge to a certain point, okay? And this point must be attracting. So in that case, you have an attracting basin. What time is it? Okay. Second case, subcase two. F is a covering, is an isometry. Isometry for the Poincaré metric. Then you have to prove that, so it's clear that I will not go to higher dimensions today, but I mean, at least you have the details of the classification. It was the end of the part one, one dimension. So I will do higher dimension tomorrow. Anyway, so F is an isometry for the Poincaré metric, okay? So in that case, if it's an isometry, if you take cluster, so it's a Fatou component, so you can always take cluster values of F converging to some mapping G on omega. And now, since F is a local isometry, G cannot be degenerate, okay? So G is also an isometry. It's a local isometry. So G cannot be degenerate. G is not degenerate. Degenerate. Okay? So if you think a little bit, this implies that if you look at f and I plus 1 minus n I, so compose with f and I of z, of course you get f and I plus 1. This is going to g of z. This is going to g of z, and g is not degenerate. So this implies that f n I plus 1 minus n I converges to the identity. Okay, so in your domain, there is a certain subsequence of iterates of fn which converges to the identity. And there's a lemma here. Lemma. Well, let me not state the lemma. So, lemma. Let omega be a hyperbolic Riemann surface and f be a covering of omega. Okay, assume there exists a sequence ni such that f and I goes to identity, so I change the name of my sequence. Then omega must be a disk or a punctured disk or an annulus, including C star is not hyperbolic, and f is conjugate to an irrational rotation. So the convergence is strict, and f and I is distinct from the identity. Irrational rotation. Okay, and the proof is not very complicated. Assume that omega is not simply connected. So in our case, this does not happen because, again, the Julia set has no isolated point. Okay, so in our case, assume that omega is not simply connected, and it must have a hyperbolic geodesic. Okay, and now you have this isometry which is close to the identity. It has no other choice of, it must send the geodesic to itself. So, if it must send the geodesic to itself, and it's an isometry. So, I mean, you have a holomorphic mapping. Locally, you have a holomorphic mapping, mapping a circle to itself, which is a certain isometry for a certain metric. If you think a little bit, there's no choice. It should be a rotation on that circle. So the geodesic is just the quotient of a geodesic by a Luxodromic element, right? So the mapping must be the quotient of some translation on the geodesic, okay? And then locally, it should look like an annulus with an irrational rotation. And then you propagate using a unique continuation, and the domain itself must be an annulus. There's a little bit of work here. And otherwise, there's no geodesic, meaning that it's a disk, and then again, an automorphism, a covering of the disk. You don't have many choices, okay? And then you get this rotation. Okay, so let me stop here. And so tomorrow, I will start by comparing that to the higher dimensional case, and I will go to this equidistribution business. Thank you.